understand a thing, when you don't, when you have no understanding about a thing, how that thing works, how that thing operates, and what that thing does, you presume. And because you presume, there is a great tendency that you will undermine the abilities of that thing. So you presume over the thing, not because you are you don't want to learn, but it's just that you don't have the time to truly understand what God wants to do. So we find that most people are like that. They presume when it comes to God. They assume when it comes to God. Well, you know, I think God is going to do this. Maybe I know God is going to do this. Oh, God, yes, God. But when you don't understand the ways of the Lord, you literally put yourself in jeopardy. Nothing hurts God. Nothing hurts God more than nothing hurts God more than when you undermine God's love for you. It grieves the Lord. It grieves the Lord when you don't understand the love God has for you and what God has designed to do with your life. Often, many people limit the grace of God for them. They limit the love of God for them. Plainly put it, when you don't have a clue, when you don't have an understanding of the goodness of God and how faithful God is, you underestimate His power for you. Covenants are things that God Himself has put in place to remind Him of His obligations towards you. All right, just hold on. I want you to really understand that. Covenants, things that God has put in place to remind Him. It's not that God has forgotten, but to remind God of His promises to you.
New entry, tone off.
To remind God of His commitment to you. To remind God of His kindness to you. Isaiah 54. How will I put it? Covenant is a contract. Okay, let me rephrase it. Covenant is a contract between you and God. Covenant is a contract, is a contract between you and God. God comes into contract with you. God makes an agreement and signs the agreement with you. It's a relationship contract, it's a covenant agreement, it's a binding commitment from God and from you. So God has a contract with you. God has an agreement with you. You and God, you have a contract. And God says in that contract, I will do this for you. I will take care of this in your life. I will defend, protect, provide, direct, guide you, cause favor to come on you, open doors, and cause you to flourish abundantly with no hindrance. And if you ever get sick or you, in your ignorance, abuse your body and break certain laws, when you repent, I will take care of you, I will heal you, I will restore you, I will guide you, I will protect you, I will bring you out again, and I will prosper you. Because I'm God, I can do it all by myself. But all I want you to do is for you to worship me. I want you to give me your very best. That's what I want you to do for me. But God, why do I worship you? Because when you worship me, you honor me and you make reverence of me before the spirit realm, because the battle is not about you and God. It's about the rebellious world that God created, that rebel against God, that makes a mockery of God. But God's nature demands that his loving kindness is given to mankind. And God says, in order for me to remain God, I want you to worship me. I want you to honor me. So I'll be relevant in man's domain. Covenant is a contract. It's a contract that God makes with us. Now, there are two kinds of covenant. There's a first covenant, which God established with Noah and Abraham, and the Old Testament church is basically a covenant that just worship me, I'll provide for you, I'll bless you, I'll protect you. If you serve me, I'll give you this, I'll make this happen to you, I'll guide and provide and protect you. I repeat that word again on purpose. And then there's a second covenant. Now, the old covenant is a good covenant, yet it was difficult for the church in the Old Testament, that is the church is the Israelite, to keep that covenant. It wasn't hard. It wasn't difficult. But the human nature, the weakness in man, hindered man to keep that covenant. Haven't you discovered it in your life that you still deal with that weakness whenever God prospers or blesses you and you are comfortable and everything is okay with you? You lose your momentum in prayer, in spiritual things. Whenever God gives you sources and grace, you begin to weak and you begin to dabble and you begin to procrastinate in the things of God. You see that? You begin to procrastinate in the things of God. You begin to undermine your responsibilities. Where you need to give God your very best. Where you need to give God your very best. Where you need to give God your very best. Where there is a need for you to give God your very best. We see in the book of Isaiah 54 verse 10 that God says to the extent he will go with his covenant. Now Isaiah 54 verse 10. For the mountains shall depart and the hills be removed, but my kindness shall not depart from you. But my kindness shall not depart from you. But my kindness shall not depart from you. Neither shall the covenant of my peace be removed, said the Lord that had mercy on thee. What's the covenant of peace? The covenant of peace simply states that I'll be your God. You'll be my people. I'll provide your needs. I'll bless you. I'll be there for you. You will have peace on this earth. Nothing will disturb you. Nothing will exist to trouble you. No challenge is there that will seize your peace. When you have peace, you can fellowship with God. God comes in a peaceful atmosphere. God operates in calmness of things. You remember the Garden of Eden? The Bible says at the cool of the night, after all the creature, everybody has run around, at the cool of the evening, God comes down to fellowship with man when he's peaceful. You remember Elijah? Elijah was bored. He thought God has disappointed him, so he ran away from Jezebel. You guys remember that? He ran away from Jezebel. And he went to the mountain of the Lord, and there was a thunderstorm, a wild wind, an earthquake, but God was not in that. God's trying to tell him that all these elements can disturb my peace for you, can disturb who I am. And the Bible says, in the stilt of the wind, a still voice came forth and asked him, a peaceful voice, Elijah, what are you doing here? The covenant of peace. You have a covenant with God, and that covenant entails that peace will reign with you. Jesus came in the second covenant, a better covenant, and says, peace be still. My peace I give to you. I don't think some of us have grasped that word. My peace I give to you. My peace, it means my power, my dominion, my glory, I give to you. In every situation you find yourself, there is peace. God says that covenant cannot be removed, even though the whole earth. In Isaiah chapter 55, verse 3, we talked about that, the everlasting covenant with you. God says in Isaiah 55, verse 3. You see, God wants to enter into covenant with you. Why? Life is full of battles. Covenant changes the battlefield of life. Life is full of battles. Job 14 says, man that is born of a woman is of few days, but full of trouble. That guy can't be wrong. And that's the reality. You live in a world of constant challenges. You live in a world of constant battles. You live in a world of constant difficulties. You live in a world of constant warfare. And God says, you can't make it without me. No man has ever made it in life without God. No matter how that you presume or you suppose they were successful, Michael Jackson, Elvis Presley, talking about the entertainment world, President India Me, Mubarak, talking about people that have power, that have ruled life, and they could kill at will and take at will, Gaddafi, I'm just talking about people, you name all the leaders. Well, there's no man on the face of the earth that can escape through life without God. God wants to make a covenant with you. God, the covenant is still there. A better one, I'll talk about that some other time. A better covenant exists for you. When you understand God's covenant and how to come into covenant with God, how to walk in the covenant of God's word, how to take that seed, which is the word of God, the seed, which is God's promises, those are seeds. And you sow it in your heart. Seeds. Seeds are the promises of God for your life. Seeds, you can convert things to be seeds, but the seed I'm talking about is the seed of the word of God right here. When you take that seed of God's word, it is the word of God's covenant. Every promise in the Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, has not expired. It has power to bring about what God says it should do in your life. When you have that seed inside of you, and that seed begins to grow and produce fruits in your life, the fruits of prosperity, the fruits of material riches, the fruit of a healthy body, the fruit of a joyful life on the earth, the fruit of happiness in the face of the earth, the fruit of life, the fruit of life. And everything you turn around to, everything you do, there's this outburst of life. That fruit is the result of the covenant of the word of God in you. A God of covenant. God of mercy. Yeah, God of grace. Cares about you. Knows what you're going through. Wants to establish you. Wants to increase your world. Wants to bless you. God, it says, incline your ear and come unto me. Yea, and your soul shall live. Isaiah 55 verse 3. When you are obedient to the word of God, God speaks. The word of God is a reality. When you are obedient to the word of God, when your whole world, your whole heart, and everything you choose to do rhymes with God's word, your world, your life, the things about you, when they all align itself with God's word, God will begin to do great and mighty things for you, with you, through you, by you, and in you. You know that God cares about you, that God truly wants to enlarge your course, that God truly wants to make you successful, that God, in his widest dream and in the best interest of God, is that you become more like him, that you become fruitful. So God says, incline your ear and come unto me. Hear, hear, and your soul shall live. When you can hear the word of God, you will have life. And I will make an everlasting covenant with you. An everlasting covenant with you. With you. Even the sure message of David. God says, you know what? I'm going to do this with you. I'm going to make an everlasting covenant with you. Every mercy I've shown to David, regardless of all his flawed lifestyle, I'm going to make a covenant with you. God is a covenant-keeping God. God is a covenant-keeping God. The covenant of God are everlasting covenant. In the book of Hebrews, let me share something to you about the new covenant. In the book of Hebrews, God established a new and a better covenant. Why? The Old Testament covenant required them to keep the law. God says, if you obey me, Deuteronomy 28. See, Deuteronomy chapter 28 is the fruit of keeping God's covenant. Let me quickly read that. Deuteronomy 28. Now, God has not changed that covenant because every word from the mouth of God cannot be altered. God will not change it. All God can do is to make a better covenant. God cannot make a weaker covenant. Deuteronomy chapter 28. Now someone might read the scripture in Deuteronomy 28 and says, wow, Pastor William, is this true? Is God still going to do this? Can God still do this? Is this still possible? Is this still a reality that these promises are true? Yes. They are the basic foundation of our success and prosperity in life. They are these promises are the basic core of every good thing that you can ever receive. Apostle William, are you sure about that? God does not lie. You can check through the history of humanity and you will find that God has never lied. And whatever God says in his word, that's what God will do. Deuteronomy 28. Let me give you some of the benefits of the covenant this morning. And it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently. You hear the word? If you will hearken diligently, if you will hear the word of God and obey, observe and to do all these commandments. Commandments are the clauses in the covenant. Oh yes, every contract must have clause. Your home, I mean those of us that live in America, when you bought your home, there are clauses. When you bought your car, there are clauses. Everything is, your job place where you work. Don't you see that after the right certain things, they now put various clauses in. Number one, you have to do this, they will do this. Number two, if you terminate this, this will be defeat. Number three, there are clauses. Likewise, God's covenant, the commandments are the clauses in God's covenant. Or some Christians or some church folks have started a new trend, say, well, don't believe the commandment is an Old Testament commandment. There's no more commandment. It's just love, 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 love. Well, in this love, we just love people. We just love God. We just love you. And that is it. That is no, there's no more commandment. It's Old Testament. We are New Testament. In fact, don't read the Old Testament. You don't need the Old Testament. Only the New Testament you need. Okay, and just put the Psalms and Proverbs. Okay, no, that's not what God said. The whole book of the law is a law. Covenant is a law. God has not abolished it. Christ came to fulfill it. So in Christ Jesus, the old covenant, the old commandment is completed on your behalf so that you don't have to struggle with the powers of darkness that want to frustrate you from keeping it. Deuteronomy 28. And it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and to do all his commandments, which I command you this day, that the Lord your God will set you on high above all nations of the earth. My God, how dare you think that you can't rise above your situation? Oh, yes, hear me real good. Oh, yeah, 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 you go. Now again, yeah, hear me real good. Wow, I don't know about you now. I got to be sure about myself because you can have a lot of people with you, but they don't know what they want. Gideon had so many people and they didn't know what they wanted. I will be above all the nations on the earth. You go, oh, some of you go, well, that is just boasting. Ah, Pastor William, come. No, no, no. By the grace of God, you will live to say it with me and witness it. In this nation, I will be above all the nations on this nation. Oh. You go, what is he saying? Some of you go, prosperous. What is he talking about? No, when you walk with the God of covenant, you are promoted and elevated above fellow mankind. You go, what? Taboo? No. It is the word of God. You are high above all nations of the earth. Above other races, other tribes, other people. Well, God doesn't say race is there, right? But what I mean by nation, nation means humanity, people of all colors, of all diversity, nations. It's not that God is discriminating because the whole people are God's children, every color. But God says, I will lift you above all nations. You can't compare today's Israel, in the Middle East, with all the other nations around it. Well, is it not God that made everybody? Yes. But there's no way you can compare Israel with other nations. God created everybody, it's true. Therefore, God has the right to favor. Oh, yes. With God, there's no favoritism. Right. That's if you're in the kingdom of God. But the blessings of God differentiates you from those that don't serve God. You are going to pray with me. Father, I decide to obey you. From today onward, my ear are attentive to your word. Therefore, because my heart is right and my ears are attentive to your glory, I am lifted up above every other nations on the earth. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I am lifted up above. I am lifted up above. Someone begin to believe God for that word. By the word of God, I am elevated, I am promoted, I am raised high above all the nations on the earth. My God, how dare certain nations look on down on you? No. The Bible says you are lifted high above all the other nations on the earth. You are elevated to a new position of God. You are moved into a higher state of being. By the power of the Holy Ghost, there's power of promotion. This year, you are elevated from today because you obeyed the word of God. When you begin to obey the word of God, when you begin to honor God, Malabrosto Zekando Brekindaba. Getebobo, the poverty will not know where you live. When you honor God, you will not lack any good thing. Hear me? When you honor God, you'll be promoted in that place of work. Everything, they may retire, even the president may be fired, but you will not be fired. I can't do you. Look at this. Do you know who you are? Yeah. Somebody pray with me this morning. You are elevated in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ because you obey God. Because I obey the word of God, I am promoted in life. I have the covenant of a common uncommon promotion. I manifest that message of God. I am elevated. My God. That's what you go. Okay. No. You know, the whole story of David, when God says the sure message of David, do you really have an understanding of what it means? Why would God say the sure message of David? What is so peculiar about David? Have you discovered in Isaiah or after David reigned, God began to use David to mirror his covenant? Because when God says, "I'll lift you above all nations if you obey my words, if you obey my word," most people thought it's too vague. So God is very smart. And God, Israel said they wanted the king, right? Then God goes about choosing a king for them. God gave them Saul. Saul was okay. They had good time with Saul. They had rebellion with Saul. Saul did not obey the voice of God. And God says, you know what? Because obedience is better than sacrifice. I want you to understand that word there. To obey God is better than what you give to God. When you obey God, when you live a life of obedience, total obedience to God, when you surrender your heart, your mind, and your entire will to God, God in His wisdom, God in His glory begins to elevate you. Obedience is the key that unlocks all of God's covenant. Obedience to God, to the voice of God, obedience to the promises, to the word of God, doing things God's way gets you in God's blessings. This year, the Holy Ghost told me, is the year of divine inheritance. Meaning this year, you entered your inheritance. You are enjoying everything that God has ever promised to man. Everything that God has ever said it will do for man and has written in the book. This year, you enter into that peace, that rest, that blessing, that progress, that victory. This year, your body is conditioned to give forth. This year, you are ready to go to the next level in life. This year, your career, your business, your calling, whatever assignment God has endowed you, you break out. This year, and it starts now. The sure message to David, the covenant, God always says it. It means, listen. I told David, I'm going to make him great. I'm going to bring a seed to sit on his throne. So the star of David, the kingdom of David will not go off. Therefore, although I told Adam and Eve that a seed will come and destroy Satan's dominion, that seed will set itself on David's throne. So because I've said so, before David was formed, I made a covenant with Abraham, and through Abraham I had Israel, and Israel became my covenant people. I'm going to raise up the seed of David in Israel. So David, by divine choice, after Saul's rebellion, when God says, I found a man after my heart, a man that will obey me, a man that will follow after what I say. Whatever I say is what he's going to do. A perfect man that will follow my will. God says, okay, David, I'm going to make your kingdom for eternity, perpetual generations. Your kingdom, the throne of David, will never end in the universe. Well, David died. Solomon messed up. And God brought Jesus. God said, okay, you are going to go and you are going to come from the lineage of David. You are going to come from the lineage of David. Because I have a covenant. I must maintain it. So though you come in to be the king of the whole universe, you're going to be addressed as a son of David. For God, the blind man, thou Jesus, son of God, son of David, heal me, son of David, son of David, son of David, son of David. The Bible, the New Testament, they call him son of David. He's a king to sit on that throne. Because God is always bound by covenant. God will do what he says he will do. David, God says, I found a man after my heart. He's going to obey me. David was nobody. David was the poorest. There's a poor man in Israel, if there's a man that has no future, uneducated, backward, dejected, rejected, upheld by his family members, was David. His father forgot his name. We always joke with that. Because when Samuel came to anoint his children of Jesse, Jesse did not even believe that it was David they were waiting for. Samuel said, don't you have any more child? He said, okay, there's one. Oh, I forgot, there's one. He's a young boy. He's in the shepherd. He's somewhere in the wilderness, taking care of sheep. How can a man of God come to your house and says, bring all your children? You were told to have all your children ready. He was coming. And you left the one to take care of your sheep. Because as long as you are concerned, what can anything good happen with his life? Somebody hear me. You might have been written out by society. You may have been written out by your own family. You may have been demoted. I have good news for you. If you will hearken to the voice of God, he said, where do I start from? Giving your heart to Christ. Become born again. Get into the word of God. You discover what God's word says about you. Begin to peruse. Begin to hunger and thirst after righteousness. Begin to discover, what is my life worth with Christ? What is my calling? Is it in the business world? What am I called? Is it in ministry? Everyone has a ministry. Whether you're a businessman, lawyer, doctor, professor, a billionaire, you have a ministry. There's something God wants to do with everything about your life. It's not saying you should quit what you're doing. You must hear God on that. Ministry means you are advancing the kingdom of God to someone. You are touching someone's life with the kingdom of God. You are advancing the cause of God's righteousness. Listen carefully, people of God. God took that same David and made him king over Israel in God's own fashion, through battles, through warfare. David overcame Goliath, overcame giants, overcame difficulties, overcame lions and bears. And David died at a very ripe old age. Oh my God. How? When David died, he was not poor. He had so much gold, so much resources laid aside for the work of God. Wow! There was a guy that lived in tent, in cave, in poverty. He went to kill Nabal because he was thirsty of meat. Went to eat sheep. Was broke in the desert. Yet, the covenant of God could not be altered by his circumstance. Your circumstances cannot change God's love for you. Hear me very well. The difficulties and challenges that may beseech you now, don't get confused about this issue. As long as you are a man born of a woman, you will have challenges. You will have difficulties. You will have troubles. Whether you stir your own trouble, will come and look for you. Whether you go out there, trouble will assist you. But the beauty of this is that you are more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus. You conquer that trouble. You overcome the enemy. So the enemy will keep on coming. It's just like the wave on the seashore. You can't stop the waves from coming to the seashore. It will come and go. It will come and go. But yet you are constant. You are that rock, that mountain, that by the coast, that no matter how the water hits hard, the water does not erode that mountain. You remain constant. because greater is he that is in you than he in the world. So you know that there is trouble in the world. You know that there is difficulties out there. You know that there are challenges out there, but they don't discourage you. Why? You have a God of covenant. You are serving the eternal God that says you will always win. God has written it out on that agreement with you that in life you are the winner. The enemy is the loser. In life you will succeed. The enemy is the failure. In life, you are blessed. Your enemies are cursed. Somebody shout hallelujah this morning. Come on, shout hallelujah. Shout hallelujah. Shout hallelujah. You blessed.
Hallelujah.
My God. God of covenant. You are putting in a higher dimension of life. Because the word of God, the word of God, God's promise is your amen. The word of God is sure. It's something guaranteed. Guaranteed. I will set thee, Deuteronomy 28. I'm telling you the covenant. This is the fruit of the covenant. This is the clauses, the reward of your obeying God's covenant. Deuteronomy 28 has it all. It's the reality of life. Is the way that life has to function. Well, you know, Apostle, I don't know, I'm just like, get up, wake up. Well, you know, sometimes there's covenant here. Talking about covenant here, you don't change it. Cannot be broken, cannot be changed, cannot be altered. It's signed in blood. The blood of Jesus still solidifies it. You can't change it. That's why the Old Testament covenant cannot expire, because Christ came to fulfill the law. And when he died and shed his blood, God says, okay, every promise, every good thing is continued in the New Testament. You will be above all the nations of the earth. Verse 2, Deuteronomy 28. And all these blessings shall come on thee, shall come on you. All these blessings and overtake thee. If you hearken unto the voice of the Lord your God. He kept on telling them, listen, there's a condition here that must be met. If you want God to bless you, there's a condition that has to be met. If you want God to supply your needs, there's a condition that has to be met. If you want God to prosper you, there's a condition that has to be met. Now, this is so interesting. This just came to my mind. Yesterday, we had a lot of partners in the Dallas Metroplex. Some of them just popped in, you know. They just popped in, surprised me. They just popped in, you know, they just came in. All right. Now, it is so you won't believe this. This is as funny as it can be. Pastor Felicia likes a particular oatmeal. You're going to say, is that simple? Oh, yes, that simple. So I got to Walmart, 3 days ago. Is it 3 days ago? Yeah, I think so. In the night after church, I quickly got a woman. I picked the oatmeal that I wanted to eat. I thought, well, the 1 minute oatmeal, the quick oatmeal. I like the original oatmeal. Let's just do something for a change. I know when I get home, if she finds, she's gonna say, honey, it's not the oatmeal I wanted. You know, I like the quick oatmeal. So I bought that, got one or two things, and I said, boy, I don't have enough change for today. I said, well, God is faithful. I'll get some change to do what I need to do. I came home. That was 3 days ago. All right. The partners came in. Boy, guess what they brought? A huge bag of oatmeal. Tons of grocery. I mean, all the partners that came to greet yesterday, it seems they had a meeting that we're going to Apostle William's house. I'm going to shipwreck him with all kinds of food from the store. pour. The fridge is overflow. I don't know where to put the stuff. Soap, grocery, dinner. And I came, I said, honey, honey, come and look at this. Isn't it interesting? Patricia called me and said, I told you I wanted quick oat. Look at this. I got the biggest one. I said, wow. Now you go, wow, that is simple. And no. I didn't tell them what to get. They want to surprise me to pay Felicia a visit. And they went the extra mile to be a blessing. Now, what am I saying? God, when you walk in God's covenant, God knows everything about you. To the least of your hair, God knows how it scents, how it smells. You don't lack any good thing in life. It will come to you if you obey God. Now, it got even more strange and weird that there's a particular partner of ours. And I was talking with another late partner that came. I said, I want to see this partner. Says, I really need to see her. I gave her a message. I says, now, you go, tell so and so that I don't mind coming to their home to fellowship with her. I need to see her husband and everybody. I want to see them. Guess what? I'm not finished talking. The phone rings. That partner was on her way coming here. I go, oh boy, this is getting so weird now. It's getting so weird. What am I trying to prove to you? God, when you walk with God, when you obey the voice of God, He knows how to delegate and connect you with things and people. Covenant. Yes, it may be simple as grocery, what you need and what you miss, and somebody bringing it to you. It could be complex as an aeroplane. Someone just got blessed and just says, I want to give you a private jet. It could be so complex, like a TV station. Someone gets so blessed and says, Pastor, I just want to bless you with this. It could get so complex that even in your life, in your business life, someone walks to you on the street and says, what do you do for a living? I've got this idea. I want to make you rich. You go, what? Yes. Blessings. The blessings of life. That's what distinguishes you from the unbeliever out there. The blessings of God. The blessings of God. God is a rewarder. That's why He has a covenant. I will do this for you. I will do this for you. I will do this to you. I will do this to you. I will do this to you. I will give you this. I will make this happen for you. I will help you get this. I will do this so that you continuously serve me. Yeah, the devil has covenant. Oh, yes. Don't underestimate stuff here. The devil also has a covenant. I keep on saying it. Some of the battles of life, the demonic affairs, the warfare, the nightmare you're going through, are based on covenant. The devil is a thief, a robber, and a destroyer. Well, but the devil is a perfect gentleman. You go, what? Taboo. No, folks, hear me. He's a perfect gentleman. He has an agreement. Your grandfather signed a covenant with him by blood. Hey, I want to be the local ruler. I want to be a rich man. Devil will give you money. He said, no problem. All I want, every son born in your family for the next 100 years. They die at certain age. They become my property. And your father, your grandfather cared less. He was greedy. He didn't understand. He had no clue about covenant. He said, is that all? Devil said, that was all. And I'll give you money. Oh, don't get yourself fooled. If you come to my village, they can make you rich. The village I'm from, Africa, if you want money, you just meet their requirement. Money will locate you. Money will come to you. You open your drawer, printed dollars or pounds. Depends on how many denomination you want it in the world. The money will be there for you to use. Oh, is it luxurious life? They can give you those things. Those are cheap things. Is it children? They can give you children even, fruit of the womb. My God, those guys are crafted in that. They will give you how many children do you want? But there's a covenant. When that time comes, you cannot spare even your life. A Because in the covenant, they have an agreement with you. You will always forget. You see, the nature of human is that man will always forget what they've agreed to do. You're looking at me and go, I don't forget. Okay, go get your mortgage covenant. Read through. Do you remember you signed those things years ago? Oh, now you are wanting prayer point to do with the mortgage company, right? But you signed it, right? I told you, you always forget. Covenant are not broken. They are nullified at the price. That's why Jesus died to pay the price. So it doesn't mean you are hopeless. No. There's hope in Christ. There's hope in Christ. But there are certain covenants, I said it again, with your eyes open, you go into this covenant and you want to get out. You can't use the devil. Oh, there was a gentleman who went into the occult. He wanted to be rich, to be a successful businessman. And lo and behold, he went into this occultic group and they gave him wealth. This guy's business exploded. Contract came, connection came. And so after a while, he was smart. So he thought, when he wanted to die, he came to the church, gave his life to Christ, became a Christian. Boy, this guy will not leave the church. At the appointed time, he died. Oh, you don't think you're smart. Yeah, don't ask me what happened after that, right? And all these blessings shall come on you, on thee, and overtake thee. God wants you blessed. God wants his blessings to overtake you. When the blessings of God overtake you, your seasons overlap each other. The seasons of life. Summer overlaps winter. And winter, summer just keeps on. Your seed time and harvest time overlap themselves. When your seed time and your harvest time overlap each other consistently, that's what called the abundant life. There's an abundance of everything around you. Because Leviticus 26:9 talks about it. It says, you will make room for the new. You will move out the old to make room for the new. You will move the new because it just keeps on coming. Someone shout hallelujah. Amen. My hallelujah. God, you are destined for greatness this year. Starting now. The blessings of God. All these blessings shall come on you and shall overtake you on the condition that you hearken to the voice of God, that you keep the covenant, that you yourself, you keep God's covenant, that you understand in life that there is a covenant agreement and you are willing to obey that covenant. Obedience to the word of God guarantees your harvest. Obedience to the voice of God guarantees your breakthrough. That's the only way out. You can't compromise the word of God. You cannot negotiate the word of God. I've seen a poor man became so financially free and prosperous that he was loaning wealth to people. Born poor, grew poor. All he had was the covenant of God's word. He understood what covenant is. He understood the power of seeds. Seed, the promises of God. That the word of God is a seed. If you sow it in your heart, if you obey that word, that seed in your spirit, man, it produces fruits, visible fruits. The seed is sown internally. The fruits manifest externally. Hallelujah, somebody.
Hallelujah.
I repeat that. The seed sows and germinates eternally, but the fruit manifests externally. Oh, I'm a born-again child of God. I believe in God. I love Jesus. Where's the fruit of it? Things happen in life. I like to use life lessons for myself. I spoke to family members yesterday back home in Africa, and there's this my aunt. Oh, I love her. She's my little mommy. I mean, she raised me up as well. My grandmother's last daughter, but she has a hot temperament spirit. So yesterday, every time I call, it's always one argument after the other. She will blow up. So yesterday, my grandma still in the hospital. Pray for her still. And so I said, Grandma, why are you not eating? You've been in the hospital since Christmas. You've been on drip. And she was trying to give an excuse. And my mom says, he's not eating, blah, blah, blah. I said, Mom, Grandma, you got to take care of yourself. Now, I know you're 100, but we don't want you to die. You at least live another 10 years, 110. That would be perfect. She has her cell phone. She still talk. Her teeth are there. So I said, wait, why don't you? I know you're tired of life, but don't be so tired. Then my aunt was there. I asked, is she there? I said, let me talk to her. She got the phone. I said, oh, my God. I told her, I said, listen, I don't want to start fighting. It's a new year. I don't just to argue. She says, oh, son, keep quiet. I'm born again. I go, whoa, you're born again. He says, yes, I'm born again. Well, I thought you were born again all my life because you go to church every day. Since I'm growing, since I was born, I know you always go to church. He said, no, I'm really a Christian now. Yeah. And she did not scream. She was nice. She said, I said, this cup for champagne. She said, yes, this cup for champagne. I was like, whoa. I dropped the phone. I go, what did I just say? She said, I'm born again. Now the fruit. I mean, I grew up knowing as a Christian. If I was born, she's always been in church choir, church, etc. But now she's telling me in her late 50s that, hey, I'm a Christian. I'm born again. The fruit. It's what we're talking about. It's not you born in church, good. Where's the fruit of the covenant? God wants to see fruit of his seed in you. Then the blessings will locate you. You don't look for God's blessings. Oh, God, bless me. Oh, God, bless. It's not going to do that because you pray 20 times. Oh, God, bless me, bless me, bless me, bless me. No. Blessings come by your obedience to the covenant of God's word. So the devil's goal in life is to cause you not to obey the word of God. That is all the demons want to do. That is all the spiritual work of darkness is all about, is to cause you not to enter into that covenant rest. Because the enemy knows that is your testimony. That is God's deliverance for you. That is God's manifestation on you. That is God's release on you. That is God's grace on you. It's you obeying the word of God. Covenant keeping God, there is no one like you. Alpha, Omega, the Alpha, the beginning and the end, there is no one. He keeps covenant to 1,000 generations. You know what that is? 1,000 generations? My God. Thousands of years and years. He is faithful. He does not change. Look at the blessing. Verse 3. Deuteronomy 28. Verse 3, blessed shalt thou be in the city. Oh, so God knows what they call city. I never knew God knew what they call. I told you it's the Alpha and Omega. He sees the end from the beginning. It says put city. I didn't say village. Put city. Metropolis. The root word for that word city is metro. Metropolis. A large urban development area. What I want to call it. Listen, wake up. I want you to wake up. Hear the word of God. You shall be blessed in the city. You shall be blessed in the city. Ayakama Soto. Oh my God.
Hallelujah.
Is somebody hearing me? There's a kind of blessing that follows you to the city. The place of your work, your job site, your business site. This year, it has to manifest. You have to cause this word to come to pass. You have to cause this seed of blessing in the city to come to pass in your life. In the city, what do you have in the city? Businesses, opportunities, connections, location. Your city today is going to function in the next few hours. But it functions based on what has been pre-planned, except there's an emergency. So they call it an emergency, a surprise. I prophesy to you today that if you will choose to obey the voice of God this season, if you will choose to walk with God, if you will choose to take the word of God and search into the promise of God, that you will be blessed this season in your city. Ah, someone believe God for it. Someone believe God for a big thing this morning. Believe God for a bigger thing than you. I'm not talking about peanut dreams here. Believe God for a big thing to take the city. You will be blessed in the city. It is God's word. He cannot lie. It's the agreement. It's a covenant. You were meant to be blessed in the city. Somebody pray with me, pray in the Holy Ghost. Let the blessings of obedience locate you. Let the blessings locate me in this city. Oh God, in this city. And every city I will put my foot upon in this life, oh God. Every city that I enter into. Every city that I embark into. My God. You'll be blessed in the city. God wants you blessed in the city.
Pastor, I don't like city. You know, city just tires me. The city worries me. When I go to the city, I get a headache in the city. Then you are cursed. Sorry, I didn't say that because you said you had headache. Hello? Oh, well, the city, you know, I hate this city. Oh, well, if you are saying you hate it, then there's a curse on you. So the city cannot bless you. Because what you say is what you're going to get. Don't forget that. You don't cancel that, right?
This is like a closed door to me. I don't know. I'm just confused in this city. When I go to the city, I just lost myself. Well, sorry. I didn't say that. You said so. Let no unwholesome words proceed out of your mouth. An unhealthy tune, an unhealthy voice. Do you know who you are when you walk in God's covenant? The covenant of obedience. There's a covenant of peace when you obey the voice of God. God is not asking you to jump off the cliff. Zion, no. There's a book of the law. There's a book, the word of God, the promises. It is written. It is given to you already. It's not something you have to invent. Don't rewrite it. It is for your good. It is written, or just obey it. These are seeds you sow in your spirit, man. You sow them inside of you. You sow the seed inside your heart. And the fruit manifests. God has already commanded a blessing ahead of you. God is not waiting for you to do. Listen, there's a blessing in obedience ahead of you. When you hear the voice of God, God says, start that business. Start a new facility stuff. And you go, no, do you think it's only Bible that God speaks to you? Come on. God is smart. Whatever you go through, whatever challenges, whatever counsel, the Holy Spirit is there. The spirit of wisdom. Hello, don't forget that. The spirit of might. The spirit of understanding. He can give you good advice in that business and you will succeed. Oh, all those phone calls you call me about your business. How do you think I have an idea of it? If not the Holy Ghost. How do you think I know what to tell you to do? Do you think I have a book I just go read about your business? Do you think I have the time to go find? No, I just pray. And the Holy Ghost speaks revelation about that business. And I give it to you. You have the Holy Ghost. The power of God for you. Listen. This year, you must manifest the covenant blessings of God. You are going to begin to decree and declare that this is your set time. Not talking about next year. This year, the blessings of the covenant must come to pass in your life. It says if you hearken unto the voice of God, if you do your part to obey the voice of God, these blessings shall come on you. I command the manifestation of these blessings now to locate you because your heart is right to obedience. Someone pray with me. Lord, I obey your voice. I hunger to see it come to pass. Your promises in my life. I hunger for you to come. I hunger and thirst for these promises to manifest in each season. Even now, as I yield my life to you, as I surrender more to you, as I focus more on you, these all good blessings begins to locate me. I am blessed in this city. I am blessed in every city under heaven. Begin to pray.
Begin to pray, begin to pray, begin to pray, begin to pray. You need to pray. Talk to God, talk to God, talk to God, talk to God. Open your mouth, talk to God. My God, you're moving to a new level. There's no place hard for you. There's no situation difficult for you. Great is your God. Great is your God. You are empowered to flourish. You are empowered to break through. Magalopro sento brekula bashanda. This is your season. 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 Do you know who you are? Look at this. Do you know who you are? How dare you walk with your head downcast? Who told you that's your birthright? God forbid. How dare you presume that you can't make it? Who told you that you are a failure? Because you're not in the covenant. You're hearing a strange voice. You know you're in the right voice. Who told you that life is difficult for you? Who told you that this year will be worse for you? The whole world will plunge into chaos, not you. Because you are bound by covenant. What happens to the world doesn't affect you. You say, but pastor, no. God knows how to protect his own. Yes. He's a clever God. Though this year, you will enter your inheritance in Christ Jesus. I say, this year, you will manifest. This starts now as you obey God's word, as the seed of the word of God is in your heart. Hallelujah. Say after me this morning, I'm a winner. I'm a champion. I'm a victor. I'm a world overcomer. I'm a kingdom financier. I'm more than a conqueror by Christ Jesus. Where others have failed in life, there I succeed. Where others are succeeding, there I prosper. Where others are prospering, there I reign. Thank you, O God, that the prayer city is built debt-free. Thank you for the prayer TV channel reaching billions of people worldwide. Thank you, O God, for the Prayer City Church Network blessed in every major city on the earth. Thank you, Father God, for opening doors for me that none can shut. I am blessed this day by the blessings of God. My going out is blessed. I'm blessed in the city. I'm blessed in the business arena. I'm blessed in the academic arena. I'm blessed coming in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. My children are taught by the Lord, and great is their peace. No weapon formed against us shall prosper, and every tongue that rise against me in judgment to put spell and curses and hex, I condemn it now to be destroyed in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I decree and declare that men shall favor me today. My name is called to be blessed today. I am promoted by my peers today. I rise above all nations on the earth today. I am above and not beneath. I am debt free. My God has supplied all my needs according to his riches in glory. I have no need or lack or want, because Christ is my all sufficiency. Hallelujah. Ooh, my God, my God, my God, my God. Say, Father God, I thank you for healing my sins. Sorry, I thank you for healing my sickness and diseases, and forgiving my sins according to Psalm 103. Therefore, I'm no longer condemned by the blood of Jesus. I've been washed and made peace with God because of the blood. Hallelujah. I have a blood covenant with the God of heaven and earth. Glory to God this morning. All right. Five and the stack. If you have a prayer request, I'm going to take your prayer request for some few minutes, and then I'm going to let you go. Don't forget, our fasting and prayer continues. Today, we won't have the afternoon prayer. We have the 3 o'clock prayers. And don't forget, you need to send in your prayer requests with those seeds if you can. I've announced it before. If every male child in your family, you have to sow a seed this season for every male child. We do that every year. And also, you want to make up your mind that this year you're going to sow your first fruit to Awen. Make up your mind. I always say, I said, if I said it first before your local church, it means it was met here. If your local church said it first before I said it, then it has to go there. So it's who first of all has the anointing to make a demand for increase on that first fruit. Your first fruit, you're giving God your first entire paycheck for that month. I know you're going to go, what? Oh, yes. But the good news is that you can spread it. You can say, okay, because of my obligations, I'm going to do this part. But you got to finish it before March, the first quarter of the year. It's a covenant work. It's a first fruit. You can't cheat God on that. You can't cheat God on that. And I also said it. If your spouse does not believe in it, then don't do it. All right? You need to be in agreement, all right, to do it. If your spouse doesn't believe in it, that is the only exemption you have. Don't do it because you are a family and the blessings of God comes upon a family. Amen? We want to give God our very best this year in our time, in our energy, in our commitment, in our passion, in our prayer life, in our walk of faith with God. I also want to encourage you to witness to people about Christ. I want you to take it at your duty today. If God creates the opportunity, if it's just one person, tell them about Jesus. Pray with them. Just tell them, can I pray with you? Let the Holy Ghost lead you. Get their number, get their names, and begin to pray for them. Begin to pray for them. You have to be glued into soul winning. It's a must. It's what's going to help you in eternity. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. All right. Five and the stacking this morning. I'm going to pray with those of you on the prayer line that needs a prayer request.